Hello and welcome to Just One More Watch. If you're a watch nerd, and let's face it, if you're watching this video, then you are a watch nerd, whether you admit to it or not. Chances are you're well aware of the kind of sport that is played within the community, that being trying to identify the watches worn on the wrists of prominent characters in TV shows, and especially in movies. Indeed, there are websites dedicated to helping you do just that. I'll leave a link to the watch-id.com website in the description of the video. However, as with all sports, some people take things just that little bit further. Not bad, eh? No, it's still me, it's still Jody, it's not Brad Pitt. Yeah, right. Like I said, there are always some people who take things just a little bit further, including Dave Deagle of the Detroit Mint Watch Company. He was so impressed with the gold Citizen 8110 Bullhead chronograph on full boon strap worn by Brad Pitt's character Cliff Booth in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood that he decided to recreate his own. Let's flip the camera and have a look at it. You saw the pop-up, I'm sure, but I'll play the siren regardless. This video is sponsored by Detroit Mint. Dave sent me these two watches in for free for review. I do not have to send them back. He did not, however, send me that fetching Brad Pitt as Cliff Booth tribute outfit. I bought myself that lot on eBay, the things I do for our mutual entertainment. You'll find a link to the Detroit Mint website in the description of the video. You'll also find a discount code, JOMWA. That'll get you 20% off anything you decide to put in your cart. I emphasize it is not an affiliate code. I don't make a cent. It just gets you a bit of a discount. These watches are $225 each. What it basically means, if you use the code, the cuff strap is normally $39 on top, or there is a stainless steel bracelet available for this stainless steel version. Effectively, you're getting one of those for free if you get 20% off, or you can get yourself a pair of sunglasses or whatever you like from their website. Four colours are available, either brushed or polished PVD gold or brushed or polished stainless steel. I will show you the stainless steel one, but really, I reckon this one is all about the gold. I tell you what this one is not about, it's not about the packaging. This is one box that you will happily put in the bin after you take the watch out of it. This is only the second Bullhead chronograph that I have reviewed on the channel over the last 4 years, so they are as rare as hen's teeth. Certainly, they were more common in the 60s and 1970s than they are now, but really, it's micro brands, brand owners who have a passion for these type of things that tend to re-engineer them these days. The other one was a Stratton Leggera, and Kyle Stratton is well known for his love of vintage chronographs. So when Dave Deagle, the owner of the company, saw the movie, he went out and bought not one, but four Citizen 8110 Bullhead chronos in an attempt to re-engineer, reverse engineer a modern version. And it has taken a few stages to get to where we are now. This was an unsuccessful Kickstarter project last year using a Seagull manual wind chronograph movement. Dave has, I think, quite sensibly opted for a Citizen Miota. It seems appropriate homaging a Citizen to put a Citizen Miota quartz in here now. I don't think this is going to be an everyday wear watch, certainly not in gold and on boond, so I've got no problems with the fact that it's quartz, especially as it's a small second. You barely notice with a small second that it is quartz. So 40 millimeters in diameter, 46 millimeter lug to lug, 13.3 mil thick, and 20 millimeter lug width. Now that is a fairly compact set of dimensions on paper and relatively compact on wrist. I'll pop it on wrist. Obviously, I'll pop both of them on wrist later on, show you the difference in how the cuff and the two piece leather wears. But it's a really, really solid and robust feeling watch head, this one. I guess another advantage of using the Citizen quartz chronograph movement rather than a mechanical of some description, apart from the cheaper cost for one, is that it's so much more robust. There are far less moving parts, far less can go wrong, and generally quartz can take a hit in the way that an auto cannot. On the optional three-piece leather cuff strap, this one weighs in at bang on 100 grams. On the two-piece standard handmade leather strap, it weighs in about 8 grams less, so coming in at 92 grams. So a stainless steel case and pushers here and crown, just a push-pull crown, but it does have 100 meters of water resistance. So if you want to put this one on the optional bracelet or on a rubber strap or something, you can get this one wet if you so choose. There's a choice of finish, as I mentioned, gold PVD coated, available in high polish, or I chose the brushed finish, and it's a circular brush. You can actually see the machining marks in the case here, quite a pronounced brushed effect. I reckon high polish gold might be just stretching the friendship a little bit.
clip. I reckon this brushed finish just toned it down a little bit, but be my guest if you prefer the high polished look. Flat sapphire crystal covering here, again a kind of modern upgrade from the old Citizens. I reckon it's kind of domed on the underside. There you go, you can see a little bit of distortion when I show you the edges of the viewing angle. I reckon that means it's flat on top, but it's a little bit concave underneath. I'll bring in the stainless one at this point to show you the case finish. Again, this is a circular all brushed one, and there's a little chamfered edge running the length of the case, which is either brushed or polished, depending on which of the case finishes you go for. Similarly, the pushers for the chrono are either polished or brushed, depending on which of the case finishes you go for, and the little D for Detroit mint there on the crown. So this is the standard supplied two-piece strap if you don't go for the Bund. Genuine leather stamped with the Detroit Mint logo and with a nice chunky buckle, again in either high polish or brush finish to match the case, depending on which of the case styles you go for. Nicely stitched. There's a third line of stitching here. There's a little red line of stitching, a kind of racing stripe, if you will, picking out the red chrono hand and subdial hands of the watch. And if I flip the watch over to the case back, again, Detroit, the home of American muscle, there is a Mustang fastback on that one, nicely embossed in the center there. Screw down, 100 meters of water resistance as discussed, and as advertised, this is the Mach model name, Detroit Mint, all stainless steel. But I reckon the optional cuff, the Bund strap, is where it's at today, especially if you've gone for the Cliff Booth Gold Special. A little bit raw in the finish, this one, raw edges, nice and comfortable in operation. Again, Detroit Mint stamped, and again having that chunky buckle in either brush or polish. Zoomed in on the dial, let's get the chrono moving by pressing what is effectively the top pusher, or what would be the top pusher if it wasn't a Bullhead, the one at 11 o'clock there. Now the calibre used is a Miyota 0S30, so it's not a Mecha Quartz or anything. You get one tick of that chrono hand per second, not the five that you would if it was a Mecha Quartz. So the Detroit Mint logo printed underneath the index at 12, and Mach, which is the model name, in red, again picking out those red subdial hands and the red chrono hand. Applied indexes all the way around. Large style batons everywhere apart from the 3, the 6 and 9, where you've got little truncated batons to make way for those 3 subdials. The 3 subdials, black with white printing, again the black, white, the red, I think it all goes very nicely, and you've got concentric circles adding a little bit of extra depth, a little bit of extra character to those 3 subdials. You've also got quite a lot of sunburst here. It's quite a rich gold here. I think it goes nicely with the brush finish. It's a slightly different tone though. I think it would also go quite nicely with the polished finish if you were to opt for that one. There is, of course, being a chronograph, a tachymeter scale around the outer edge. It's on a rehote though, and there's a printed minute markers and fifth of a minute markers on the main dial just within that. You'll also see little circular marks beyond the indexes. There's some loom here. It's a fairly simple handset, but they managed to incorporate some loom down the middle. I'll put in the loom video now. The loom is not going to win any awards. It's okay if not outstanding. I guess 100 meters of water resistance and a touch of loom will add to this one's all-round general versatility and practicality. If you've got a big set of cojones, then you can opt for it in gold. If you're perhaps a little bit more mild-mannered, then maybe the silver would make a reasonable choice as a left field daily. And one more push off the bottom pusher, i.e. the 1 o'clock one, will stop and reset. I think overall the dial is attractively done. It's not overdone. It is busy, but it's nicely well laid out. They haven't put a date in here. The 0S30 doesn't have a date option. I've seen chronos with the date kind of hacked down there at the 4:30, ruining the symmetry. I'm glad they haven't done that, because I suspect, in spite of its practicalities, most people will not be wearing this one as a daily. Let's get it on wrist then, starting with the gold one on the Bund strap. Now I've got a 7-inch wrist for your reference, and I have got 2 holes to the interior and 4 spare holes to the exterior. I reckon that means this one has got a kind of wear size of between 6.5 inches minimum to about 7.75 inches maximum on this strap combo anyway. And I think it looks pretty spectacular. Look at that luscious gold toned colored dial. Nice bit of sunburst coming off there as I flex my wrist. And that is the brushed stainless steel version for a comparison on the supplied two-piece leather racing strap. Looks a little bit conservative when compared to its gold cousin, if a Bullhead chronograph could ever be described as conservative. The dial on this one is silver, obviously, rather than gold, but it also has a sunburst effect, and it also has a really nice rich sheen when I show you it from certain angles. Outside with the gold one, you can see that sunburst effect quite prominently. You can also see what I mean about the distortion from the sapphire crystal when I move it to the edges of the viewing angle. Similarly, when I put the watch on wrist with that boon strap, again, if I hold it at certain angles, you can see distortion rather than the dial. In practice, it's not that big an issue, and I guess it does add a little bit of kind of retro vintage appeal to the look overall. So a pair of watches today that are as chunky as they are funky, but what are my complaints? What are my moans and niggles? Well, I called out the packaging earlier on, not all that auspicious, and I cannot find any details as to what warranty is offered on these, so do inquire yourself before you pull the trigger if you intend to buy one. I would hope for 2 years given that it is a quartz movement in both. Not expensive watches, you know, you're going to have to expect a few limitations here and there, and the lume is certainly a bit of a drawback on these. It's not all that fantastic, to be honest, and I found just one little QC moan with each of them. I'll throw in some macro here of the gold dial version. The printing on the 60-minute sub-dial at the 9 o'clock was a little bit patchy, a little bit light in places. From certain angles, you can see it's not quite as dark. It's not quite as black as it should be. And on the silver dial version, the chrono hand is a little bit cockeyed to the right. These can obviously be reset. You can pull out the crown and adjust them around that way if you have managed to miscue it. I've done it a couple of times, though, and it always resets. Back to 12, but it resets slightly squinty. But like I said, these are not particularly expensive watches. I don't think Dave is price gouging at all here. 225 less 20%, you're paying 180 for one. Quartz chrono for 180 with sapphire crystal, 100 meters of water resistance. I think that is perfectly reasonable. $40 on top if you want to add one of those cuff straps. But if you do go for the gold and the cuff strap, ask yourself how often you're going to wear it. I reckon this one is a keeper for me. I'm going to keep the cold one on the cuff strap long term. It featured in my State of the Collection video a couple of weeks ago, but I keep it in the knowledge that I will probably wear it 3 or 4 times a year at most, and I'm okay with that.
So there you have it, the Detroit Mint Mach. Perhaps not an everyday wear. I can't see too many people rocking up to the office on Monday morning with one of these on their wrist, but as an occasional wear piece, a bit of a novelty item, I think this one is a cracker. Much like my outfit, I'm not quite sure when I'm going to wear the yellow Hawaiian shirt again, but I'll definitely be rocking the t-shirt. Thanks for watching. I will see you in a future video.